There's a story about this cantankerous old man. He was a crabby old man. His neighbors avoided him. His four boys even moved away from home so they didn't have to be around him. You kind of get the picture. He's not well liked. His poor wife, though, stood by him through thick and thin. But it was not easy. One night, he went to bed and he slipped away. His four boys were called in. What should they do? He was hard to live around, one of them said. No one could get along with him, but he was our pa. We owe him a decent burial out in the meadow beyond the field. So they went to the barn and they found some boards and they made a casket. They put the box on their shoulders and carried it out past the barn. As they passed through the gate, one of the boys bumped into the post and caused them to drop the box. The casket broke open, and a cantankerous, crabby old man sat straight up. He wasn't dead. He was in a very deep sleep. Well, life got back to normal. He lived for a couple more years as ornery old man, cantankerous and crabby as ever. The boys went back to their homes. His poor wife, she stayed put and she stayed with him all the way through. Then one night he went to bed and he slipped away. This time for good. His poor boys were called. What should we do now? Well, said one of them, he was a hard man to live around. No one could get along with him. He was our pa, though. We owe him a decent burial out in the meadows beyond the field. So they went to the barn and made a casket. And they put the old man in it, put the box on their shoulders, and they started out of the house. As they did, their mother, the old man's crabby's wife, said sternly, "Boys, when you get out there by the barn, be careful going through that gate." Yeah, that's kind of a funny one there, but yeah, maybe that cantankerous old man should have had our lesson that we got for today from Ephesians 4. Our lesson goes like this: "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice." He goes on to say, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Jesus Christ forgave you. Follow God's examples. Therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." Well, that cantankerous, bitter old man, you know, he had no friends, you know, and I'm sure you probably know some people who are like that. They're crabby. They have nothing good to say about anybody. And if they had their way, the whole world would be upside down. Dr. David L. Brown tells about a man who died with bitterness in his heart. His name was Sigmund Freud. He was one of the most influential psychotherapists who ever lived. Well, he died at the age of 83. He wrote in 1918 of something that basically laid out the foundation of his life, the way he viewed the world. That's not the way we want to view it, but this is what he wrote. "I have found little that is good about human beings on the whole. In my experience, most of them are trash. No matter whether they publicly subscribe to this or that ethical doctrine or not at all." Kind of sounds like some people you see on TV today. Everybody is trash. Nobody is good. Nobody knows what they're talking about. Freud died as friendless as you can get. No friends, nobody to be around. Paul says that there are six vices that we're supposed to get rid of. Get rid of them out of our life. They're like weeds growing in our garden. We need to pluck them out and get rid of them. They are bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, and malice. Sounds like a session of Congress, doesn't it? The way they go on and they seem like they're always bitter against each other, and they're always brawling and they're angry and they can never get along in Congress. Well, if we have any of those characteristics in our hearts and our minds and our souls, we need to get rid of them. Paul says, get rid of those vices. You don't need them. You should live a positive life. You should live an inspirational life. Reader's Digest recently had an article that was called Angry Heart. Did you know that anger can lead to a real heartbreak? A person's risk of having heart attack increases nearly fivefold within 2 hours of having an angry outburst. It doesn't pay to get angry. This is what a recent Harvard University, they have reviewed 6,000 people who experienced this cardiovascular event. You know, when you get really angry, your whole body gets into it, and your blood vessels probably start coming up, popping out, and your brain, you start sweating, and the whole body just strains. This past week when I was down in Condi and Bobby from mosquitoes down there, Pierre, who works in the public works department down in town, he was telling me about, I think it was his son that was going to schooling. One of the things that they tried to make you do was to be angry for 3 minutes. I mean, for a whole 3 minutes solid, you are to be angry and screaming and everything you possibly can at the top of your lungs, as loud as you can, as emotional as you can for 3 minutes. They couldn't do it. No one could pass that test. You see, because anger takes so much out of you. You know, so if somebody's angry at you and they start hollering at you, all you gotta do is just kind of sit there and let them get it off their chest, because they're gonna run out of energy. They'll run out of steam. They won't be able to keep it up, because they can only be angry for a couple minutes, and then after that, they're exhausted. Bitterness, rage, anger, bawling, slander, and malice are our enemies, and we need to get rid of them. How do we get rid of them? By having a good role model in our lives. Role models are so important. If you hang around people who are positive attitudes, you're going to have a positive attitude. If you hang around people who are negative and always bring you down and they don't have a good thing to say, guess what? That's what you're going to be. So you kind of person needs to kind of look at your life and say, what kind of friends am I hanging around? If I'm hanging around people that are bringing me down, you know what? Maybe it's time to weed the patch. And sometimes that's tough to do, because sometimes those are our friends. Well, if they're really our friends and they want to keep bringing us down, that's not good for us. That's not good for our emotional level. It's not good for our spirituality. We need to hang around people who are good and positive people. In the 1987 movie Wall Street that starred Michael Douglas and Charlie Sheen, it's a film that talks about Charlie Sheen, who is a young stockbroker who falls under the influence of Gordon Gekko, who is played by Michael Douglas. Michael Douglas is a sleazy but wealthy, power-hungry, unscrupulous corporate raider. The film sought to portray the greed and the excess of the 1980s. The motto was, greed is good, back in the 1980s. You know, it won an Academy Award for Best Actor for Michael Douglas, who did a magnificent job of portraying what happens when profits become more important than people. But Michael Douglas said, you know, many years later, people still approached him and said they went into the stock business because of that movie. Because of the character in that movie. Because they wanted to be scrupulous and greedy and so forth. That's not the way we want to be. We want to live a positive life. So we need a positive role model in our life. Of course, Jesus Christ should be our role model. Outside of that, we should have real human beings as well as good, positive role models. You probably heard of Zig Ziglar. He's a legendary motivational speaker. He lost his dad when he was about 5, and his mother had a 5th grade education. And so they really struggled through times. The guy who ran the local grocery store, his name was Mr. John R. Anderson, he took Zig and his younger brother into the store. Now, they couldn't really do much in the business. They were pretty young, but he took them in under his wings. Really able to help. You see, Mr. Anderson was a successful businessman. He had impeccable character, and he had a sense of godliness. And Zig says to be successful, he doesn't mean materialistically, he means spiritually. And hanging around Mr. Anderson and his meat market manager, Mr. Walton Haney, they were able to lead a godly life. Because of the people they hang around. If they wouldn't have hung around them, who knows how they would have turned out. So it's more important, like even for Preston, as he grows up, it's important that he hangs around good, positive people, right? Yeah, you know, because those are the people that are going to mold your future in the way you're going to be down the road. It's also a story that appeared in the Christian Herald several years ago about a senior executive in one of the largest New York banks. He had risen to a place of prominence and influence, but you know, that's not how he got his start. He got his start as an office boy. And as an office boy, pretty soon the president of the company came and said, "Hey, I want you to come into my office. I want you to be with me every day." And the boy said, "I'm too young. I don't know anything about this business. What can I possibly help you out with, sir?" "Oh, never mind that," he says. "You will learn what I want to teach you a lot faster if you just stay by my side. Keep your eyes and ears open." Sometimes I think we talk too much. We don't listen. We don't open our eyes. And that's the road we need to go down. We need to be able to listen to the good people around us. Close our eyes to those people who want to bring us down. Because you see, we're better than that. Jesus wants us to be better than that. It's important to have the good role models. I really like this next story. It's about a marathon runner. Or this Gail, her name is Nancy. She was a faithful jogger for years. She never tackled a full marathon, but she really wanted to do that. She says, you know, she told her husband, Mark, "I think I'm going to join the club, the marathon club there, and I want to get somebody, be around people who are going to help me to fulfill my dream." So she went to her first practice, and she came home, and Mark says, "Well, how did it go today?" "Awful. Terrible. I think I'm the worst runner in the world. The other people in the club, they ran 3 times faster than me. They run. I waddle. Maybe I should quit the club," she says. "Oh, no, it can't be that bad," Mark says. "Try again. Try tomorrow. I'm sure it'll be better." Next day she goes back and says, "Well, how was it today?" "Oh, just terrible. I think I'm going to quit. There's no way I can keep up with them people. They run so much faster than me." "Well," Mark says, "let me come with you tomorrow and see what's really going on." When they arrived at the college where Nancy's club was trained, he understood why Nancy felt so out of place. She had joined the famed Santa Monica Track Club. That's where members included like Carl Lewis and Evelyn Ash were some of the fastest runners in the world who won Olympic medals. Mark watched Nancy run around the track with a respectable pace. The others were going about three times faster than her. It was no wonder that she felt all class. Then the next words that Mark said were really important. He says, "They do run a lot faster than you, Nancy, because they are the fastest runners in the world. Next to them, you look pretty pathetic. But, don't compare yourself to them. Do your own best." I remember like when I talked to track coaches and cross-country coaches, they would always talk about, so-and-so improved in their time from last week. They got a little faster. They improved their own time. Now, maybe they didn't place high, but they got better. They're getting faster. You need to look at your own, how you can improve on yourself. And not worry about what everybody else is doing. You're not going to be a Carl Lewis and run the marathon, big, but they did encourage her. She did run a marathon. She ran a respectable race. She didn't get a gold medal or anything like that, but they still made her feel welcome. They were basically role models for her. St. Paul writes, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ God forgave you. Follow God's example. Therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the ways of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to you." We're supposed to pattern our life again with Jesus Christ. Because he is our mentor. He is our role model. He is the one. You know, Paul says it great in Ephesians 5:1. He says, "There is no higher goal, no greater aspiration for the people of God than to imitate God." It's going to be pretty tough to imitate God. So we should do our best. We can't be God-like, but we can certainly try to be something that God would like us to be. Something better. Something positive. Be a positive influence. I know. When I go to City Hall Monday mornings, usually I stop in the morning bright and early. They open up about 8 o'clock, and then sometimes I stop in about 8:50, and I walk in. "Oh, good morning, my fellow Americans! Off to a glorious start. How is everybody today?" I come in all enthusiastic, and they just look at me and she's like, "Really? It's Monday morning. It's too early to be cheerful in the day." They tell me, "Oh, no, 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 it's never too early to be cheerful. That's the way to get the day started. You know, good morning, my fellow Americans. Be positive, be inspirational." And it rubs off on people. And you know, there are some days when I go in there, I myself don't feel so energetic. It's like, ugh. So I go in there, "Good morning, my fellow Americans," and on and on. And you'd be surprised that when you do that yourself, maybe you're feeling down, but you go in there and you give this inspirational, positive feeling to other people, it comes back to you. And it makes you feel better too. It's like, "Hey, that was pretty cool." You can get over those challenges in life. You can, you know, God is so great and wonderful. If only we could just grab on to a tenth of minute part of his spiritual blessings. Oh man, we could really go far. We could tell books to fly. We could tell mountains to flip themselves down, you know, upside down, like Jesus said. The faith the size of a mustard seed can do miracles. Only we could have that faith. Well, maybe we can't have that gigantic faith experience, but maybe we can have a small faith experience. Again, don't compare ourselves to, you know, some people who are really high up on the totem pole. Don't worry about them. Be yourself. Be the best of yourself that you possibly can. And always try to be positive. I know sometimes it's tough to wake up in the morning and go, "Ugh, it's raining out. It's a dreary day. I don't look very good." And sometimes we wake up with a negative attitude. Oh, and if that's the way sometimes you are, you really need to And it takes time. It really takes time to change your mind. You get up in the morning and say, well, dear, it's a good, it's a beautiful morning. And you probably look out the window and say, it is? Oh, of course, we're alive, everything is great, everything is wonderful. We got hailed out last night, but everything is still great. You know, and sometimes bad things happen to us, but you can't let them bring us down. You still got to wake up in the morning and say, it's a wonderful day to be alive. It's a wonderful day to be on this planet. It's a wonderful day to have family and friends around us, people who care for us, people who love us, and more importantly, Jesus Christ does that. He loves us. He forgives us. He wants us to have kindness and compassion and forgiveness. God is so wonderful. So, you know, in the morning, you two will probably work on this together, you know, you were a little bit negative this morning. Let's try some positive. Let's do something positive. Let's try this again. You know, sometimes I'll do it. Let's try that again. I'll do that in church. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I just look out in the crowd and say, really? Let's try this again. Good morning, everybody. And then they are a little bit more cheerful. You know, sometimes you just have to kind of practice at it and make it better. So, the challenge for the day is to weed the patch. Get rid of it. Pull up bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, and malice. Get rid of them. Pull them out of the garden and plant seeds of kindness, compassion, and forgiveness. And let Christ be our role. Live and love as He did and begin a new life with Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for sending Jesus into the world. We thank you for turning Saul into Paul to be that great inspirational writer for us, to teach us your way and wrote so much of the New Testament. It is a great, wonderful feeling to have a positive life, to be inspirational, to try to encourage and uplift other people around us, Heavenly Father. And if sometimes we do fall by the wayside, Heavenly Father, lift us up and say, come on, my child, we need to get going. We need to be inspirational. And we need to hang around people who are positive and inspirational and uplifting, because that's how our life is going to be formed. We need good role models in our lives, Heavenly Father, and allow them to come into our lives to teach us and to encourage us. Thank you, God, for everything you've given us in our lives. We pray this all in Jesus' name, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now receive with believing hearts the benediction of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious upon you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace, love, and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And let God's people say, Amen. Amen.